Thank you all for coming. I'm very excited to be addressing the Cassandra Summit today. I've got a team back at Accenture Technology Labs that's been working with Cassandra for the last couple of years, and we're thrilled to be able to talk about the work we've done and share it with the community. So thank you all for joining us. Today I'd like to talk about time series data. Jonathan mentioned this morning that it's a very common use case for Cassandra. A couple of years ago, we were facing some challenges around certain kinds of time series data for our clients, and looking at the range of solutions that we could bring to bear on that problem, everything from specialized historians to relational databases to flat file systems. And through the course of a lot of evaluation and experimentation, began working with Cassandra for that problem and have been very pleased with our abilities in that respect. So what I'd like to do is talk a little bit about the properties of time series to set the stage for why Cassandra is very, very good at time series. Talk a bit about how what we've built compares to those other options that we looked at, and finally talk about where we're going with it. And the it in this case being a time series analytical repository. So time series is a form of data. Analytical repository implies a range of use cases for that data, or at least that those use cases include analytic traversals and fun stuff like that. So first a word from my sponsor. My slides don't seem to be advancing. There we go. First, a word from our sponsor. I come from a group called Accenture Technology Labs, and so it's my job and my team's job to look at emerging technologies and understand how to apply them for the benefit of ourselves and our clients. We put together a technology vision every year, and it's worth noting that this year, two of the six major technology trends really are about big data. On the one hand, it's about bringing the worlds of the existing world. There was a question from the last session of how do I bring the existing assets of my organization to bear on these new data sources, and how do we marry structured and unstructured data? And the cute little picture of the tattooed arm and the elegant arm coming together is one major thing we're thinking about. And the other is then how do you distribute this data to the organization? And then we start talking about data services. So the larger context of problems we're solving are large-scale enterprise data management challenges, where typically we're trying to unlock a data, enable an organization to become truly data-driven. So what is time series data? I'll take a slightly different definition than Jonathan did this morning, but essentially, it's a series of measurements at regular intervals, as the source of all wisdom in the world Wikipedia says, more or less. But essentially, it's information that has a natural ordering in time. It gives us an index and a frame of reference across all time series data that shares a common clock since the longitude problem was solved and we decided that somewhere in Greenwich, England was where we wanted to measure time from, we've had this reference point that we can look across different series of data. It implies different kinds of analytical workloads. Because the data has a natural ordering instead of some bag of observations, there's natural types of analytics we want to do, and so there's some unique requirements that both give us some clarity in terms of how we look at the architecture we want to put behind it, but also put some requirements on us on the kind of tools we want to use with it. So we collect all this stuff to analyze it, and there's basically two sort of access patterns that are common and when you're looking at time series. And on the one hand, I call one of them the horizontal or state view, which is give me the latest status across all of these sensors or something like that, right? So if I'm operating a power grid, it's what is the current state of all the assets on the grid I have visibility into, right? And I characterize that as a wide or a horizontal query. That's typically goes along with sort of lower latency monitoring tasks and features patterns like event detection and things like that around operations or supply chain when we're trying to manage a complex state. The other access pattern being vertical is it tends to be looking at historical segments of data across a collection of sensors often, but typically more around things like forecasting and building predictive models. And this is where a lot of ad funnel analysis and things like that go as well. So, you know, there's a lot of different traversals, and with most data stores, when you've optimized for one, you've just de-optimized for the other access pattern. So one of the things we like about Cassandra is that it makes those choices less painful and less permanent. One of the big motivating or the big data sets that we worked with originally was smart meter data from utilities, because it's more or less a greenfield data source within a lot of our customers that current solutions were designed to store one read every month, and now you're getting 96 a day, and really the architecture doesn't translate. So while they're probably still printing your bills off the legacy systems, we need new management techniques to deal with that kind of volume of data. Another important thing to keep in mind about time series data is that it's most fruitfully viewed in context. Just understanding some variation in the temperature of a device can tell you a lot of interesting information, but putting that in the context of the system that device operates in probably allows you to understand a lot more. So I've just thrown some examples of the kinds of context that we commonly deal with. You have things like an electrical grid, which is essentially a connected graph, and it's directional, or else you've got problems. You've also got other hierarchical systems. You've got processes where you've got you're making observations about activities that form a larger process, and unless you bring that context to it, you won't understand the full process. And finally, as I've heard mentioned several times today, there's data sitting around in all these old enterprise systems, right? In this case, it's outage management systems or GIS systems. And all of that context needs to be brought to your time series data. And as my friend Matt File observed in the last session, there's big data and then there's the other data. And even though we've been working with this smaller set of data for a long time, this new big data store typically dwarfs the existing data in terms of volume. So it's usually more efficient to bring the relational data to the non-relational data than vice versa, because managing that volume was the reason we got non-relational data stores in the first place. But to make this a little more real, I like to work through a little bit of an example. And these are all unlabeled because I essentially make this up every time I talk about it. But I've picked one example here. And so you can see that there's some kind of time series here. And it involves observations of latitude and longitude and some kinds of IDs. And so really, if we just know that this little middle section here, where 45684853, which I've decided is an employee ID, is stationary for a certain amount of time. And a lot of man-down systems would take that and say, well, if somebody is stationary for too long, that's a problem and we'll send help, which is great. But if you know what process that person is doing, and for instance, you've observed that they've opened a valve right before this process began and been stationary for a while, if you understand what step they're in that process, you can decide if that being in that place for that period of time is interesting or if it's normal. So by bringing that additional context to the data, we can do a lot more with it. So it's something we really want to think about as we think about our storage architecture for the time series data itself. So the kinds of things we do with the data, We tend to map business use cases to the technical use cases that they translate to. So, BI and reporting is heavy on aggregation. Forecasting, obviously, is heavy on trend analysis. Things like condition monitoring pull in all kinds of things, like distributed state analysis, event processing, and anomaly detection. But all of these use cases have a fairly manageable set of analytical and traversal patterns that Cassandra, fortunately, and much to our pleasure, does a very good job of implementing. We tend to bring all of these things to bear with some kind of visualization. The more data you're generally talking about, the more you have to reach to some technique to provide understanding of that. It could be just a reduction. You're finding some needles in the haystack, and once you find something interesting, that interesting thing is tractable, but sometimes you need to describe things, and the only way to do it is really to put it in some visual format. So it's important to think about how these analytics get delivered to a decision to actually change a business outcome, because after all, that's what we're after. So why is Cassandra good at this stuff? So the classic pattern of time series data is write once and read many times, and it's typically appended in order. So you don't really care that your data structure is essentially immutable and you're appending to the end of it. In fact, that's perfectly suited to this kind of data. So you're playing to the strengths of the architecture in that respect. You tend to read data in time order, and that tends to be how it gets organized within Cassandra. So it supports that vertical access pattern very, very well. And then when you're doing the horizontal access, you've got essentially distributed searching kinds of benefits going for you as well that makes retrieval of some of those states very, very efficient. So at a high level, some of those properties are very, very useful when we drill down a bit into that. You know, we look at things like storing columns in sort order by name, column time to live. These are very, very useful, right? We use time order by name in our data model, and I'll show that in a second. Time to live, when you're essentially organizing your data with timestamps or time as columns, gives you a nice way of sort of automating the archive process. You essentially can control very easily how the data is growing as you're adding more time and how you're sunsetting old data very efficiently. You need support for wide tables, right? If you're going to try and capture the data of a sensor that's giving you data every 20 seconds or every 15 seconds or even 120 times a second in some cases, that's going to be a lot of columns, and fortunately, Cassandra is good at that. And the reason that we like using columns that way is it supports range queries across those time segments, which is one very, very common use case or analytical traversal in a time series application. So, you know, we think, you know, one data entry per column and using timestamp as the column name gives us a lot of flexibility, and I'll show that in a second. Random partitioning and parallel key search allow that composite row and plus composite row keys allow us to search and aggregate usefully. So we arrived at a data model that looks more or less like this. Essentially using asset IDs as the row key. So if this is smart meters, then each meter has its own row. And then name value pairs where the column name is, as I said, is the time span, the time stamp, and the value is the magnitude of the meter reading in this case. So that data model supports a nice query access when a lot of what we want to do is understand sums over time, right? So the basic process of billing you as a utility, after all, is adding up how much energy you used in the period and sending you a nice bill. And we found it to be very, very effective doing that. It also enables us to use, so we build some of the context into the row keys to allow us to efficiently aggregate around things like jurisdiction or other business categorical schemes that depending on the categories that are relevant to the time series you're building. Another interesting thing we wanted to do was test this up in a cloud. And interesting from a utility perspective, in the US at least, they like spending your and my money on large capital projects because they make their money on the reasonable rate of return from those. In Europe, they don't, and they're much more interested in getting off of hardware, but we chose to do it in a virtual environment because it actually is much easier to test out architectures that way, and we were trying to prove out certain capabilities where we didn't think the difference between a virtual environment and a physical environment would really make a big difference for us. And so we did this up on Amazon, and essentially with the object on the left pointing at the cluster there is a bit of stub we built on Elastic Beanstalk to stream reads at our cluster at realistic volumes and make sure we could write fast enough. And then on the right, we have the consuming applications. We had one that was a stand-in for customer portals and one that was a stand-in for analytical applications to do some testing around that. So we basically set this up, loaded up with about 1 million meters worth of data for about a year, which is roughly 10 gigabytes or so, and did some testing to understand how does this perform, and in particular against some reference points around relational databases on specialized hardware that is a common preferred alternative in that particular space. So when we look at how it compares, like I said, we started out on this journey for a reason, and that's because the existing solutions we found to be very, very inadequate for the growing volume. So they're in a lot of process manufacturing and supply chain industries. You see specialized data historians, which are essentially the original columnar databases, but they tend to be very specialized data stores meant for engineering applications, and they're very good at reading a sensor stream, but didn't contemplate a world where a large-scale system integrator would want to come in and load up some testing data in bulk and not stream sensor at it, right? So, so working with these things in an enterprise context is very, very difficult. they're also very, very expensive to scale. They grew up in the big iron era. Now we have commodity hardware to play with that we didn't 30 years ago. And the scaling properties that give us are very, very important. there's a high cost associated either with the appliance approach or with the niche approach. So, data tends to remain in silos, and those applications don't tend to support the broad range of analytics we want to do. They tend to support very narrow range of engineering problems and real-time monitoring solutions. Using the good old relational database, which we did for a while because that's what we had, gets you so far, but there's a lot, you're buying a lot of features that you're not using, right? I joke, I'm from Accenture, we did a lot of accounting systems, we're really, really good at accounting or accounting things, and a lot of the best practices around transaction locking and things like that were actually developed in the good old days of Anderson Consulting. And that has a place when we're talking about exchanging money and fun stuff like that. If I give a bartender a 20, I want to make sure that he understands he got that 20 and I get my 2 pints of beer back, please. And that's a very, very important transaction. If I'm just trying to understand the temperature of that beer over time, I don't necessarily need to agree that every reading was perfect. I just want to have a set of readings that I can actually understand the temperature of my beer before it hits my lips. So, so there wasn't a good solution, and we looked at the world of available technologies and found Cassandra to be very appealing for these kinds of use cases. In particular, we did a set of queries. So essentially, the first 5 there are 1 meter, which means essentially 1 row key. So it's a needle in a haystack, and pulling that vertical history so that you can present it to somebody on their customer portal. So when you go up to your utility's website and they've convinced you to let them install a smart meter, now you can see in very fine grained detail your power usage. The last 3 there are around taking a particular time slice and looking across broad ranges of keys, right? So that's sort of that analytical or state use case. And what we did was we ran these both on our system up on AWS and on the specialized hardware appliance running a relational database. Now, a few comments about this, and everybody's going to start looking at the chart, and what I want you to take away from the chart is that the gray areas and the blue dots are all roughly in the same places. We didn't actually spend, I think we spent a grand total of a week tuning our solution before this set of tests ran. We've learned a few things since then, too, but all we were really trying to establish was that we were in the same ballpark as the $10 million worth of iron and software that was sitting over there as the alternative. so we didn't so much set out to break their performance so much as establish that we were a credible solution. And so clearly this does that. So what you see here is that the range of response times from a relational database is the gray bars, and then the average response time when hitting Cassandra, which we found to be quite consistent, is in the blue dots there. So in a lot of cases, it's faster when you get up to some of the really big queries where data transport becomes an issue. It starts to push out to the farther range of some of the RDBMS stuff. But the point is, it's comparable. And we didn't even really roll our sleeves up and get dirty trying to make it fast yet. Also, we did it basically up on AWS on big instances. So whilst we weren't dealing with complete randomness in terms of our data locality and things like that, we were on a cloud, so we weren't pushing performance from that perspective either. And still, trying very, very hard to spend something on the order of $10,000 a month, we were in the ballpark of what amounts to a $10 million investment in hardware and software. If you make that $10 million investment in hardware and software, some people get to buy new sailboats and have sailing competition.
One outlier?
So the one outlier was use case 10, which is essentially 50,000 different keys. And what's dominating that result is the transport, actually. So it's not even, if you look at when the query finishes, it's actually quite comparable. It's just that the transport was baked into the architecture somewhat differently, and that's what's dominating that. And like I said, we didn't try very hard on most of these use cases, and there's certainly some optimizations you could make in your architecture we've learned about since that I'm happy to take offline that would address some of those issues. So it's pretty profound, right? $10,000 a month versus $10 million. In sort of a cheap and cheerful solution, some might say, and certainly one needs to put some things around this to truly make it a comparable offering, but it's a pretty compelling value proposition to a CIO. So those who were wondering from some of the earlier sessions on, you know, how you get an organization willing to adopt these technologies, that's a pretty compelling version of it. Well, I'm going to take a quick business break here with you. And attempt to arm you all with the argument around why one should build analytical solutions on top of these technologies that will appeal to your CEO or CFO, which is somewhat similar, but if you think about doing these solutions on traditional architectures, essentially your cost per unit of storage processing increases as you increase in scale, right? A 10 terabyte Oracle install, for instance, is not the same cost per terabyte as a 100 terabyte Oracle install. And so as cost increases, it begins to overwhelm the value proposition of the uses you might put that data to. And essentially, organizations get in a posture of prioritizing data use. And if you've ever been the analytics guy going to talk to a DBA and asking if you can get access to his database, you sort of understand this intuitively. They tell you to go away. They're measured on SLAs. Don't mess up my reports. That's what gets me fired. I don't care if you have a $100 million value proposition for the CEO. I'm not going to make any money on there. And away we go. So all of those other projects that are potentially valuable to the right there don't get done. In a horizontal scaling world with an architecture like Accenture, they do. You no longer have that barrier to using data in as many decisions as possible. Sure, there's some minimal threshold of value to get out of bed in the morning, I suppose, but you know, it's not free, but the cost isn't increasing by unit, which means if I have more uses for data, I just add more commodity hardware, and I'm able to accommodate that, and I don't jeopardize the performance of my reports and all that fun stuff. So that really actually changes everything. That's the difference between working in an organization where it takes 6 months to get a column added to a report, and if you want to do and test some theory that I would argue you should use numbers and math and fun stuff like that to be data-driven in your decision-making, this is the strategic argument of how you do that from a technology architecture standpoint. So we think we've been very, very successful in terms of building out an architecture to meet the use cases of time series in the general case, and we've done a lot of work on how we do that in combination with the analytics and use cases that the organizations who consume that data need. Most of the, like I said earlier, most of those solutions grew up in silos where it's very, very hard to get access to that data outside of an organization. And I've talked to countless clients who, if they could, would love to make data generally accessible in their organization. but they have grown up in a context of data silos where the value proposition has to be internal to a specific department to get anything done, and it gets very, very hard to introduce technologies into those environments. So you do see some strategic-minded CIOs actually starting to realize that it isn't just about keeping the lights on, and that if they actually change their posture, they can provide a value-added architecture to their organization and change the way it does business pretty profoundly. There's some people in process that need to go along with this too. Just because you have the ability doesn't mean that your organization can change because of the insights that the analytics deliver. So it's not this simple, but this is the technology and economics argument to make the rest of that conversation go much more smoothly. So we've built some cool stuff, and I really still feel like we're at very early days in our journey, both with Cassandra and with building the architectures that make these things come together. Most of our testing was around very simple query use cases to support, you know, simple aggregations for customers, or simple kinds of forecasting for planners. And that's all great, but where we're really seeing this going is driving a whole new class of enterprise analytics, and the analytics tools and the visualization tools are growing up around Cassandra to make that possible. So I'm going to spend the last few minutes talking about some of the work we're doing both from an application standpoint and from a tool standpoint to begin to assemble the ability to use this data more fruitfully. And the prize is really analytically driven applications. These are a couple that my team have built. The one on the left is actually meant to monitor the condition of assets for offshore drilling in the Gulf of Mexico. Apparently, we developed it a bit too late. The one on the bottom right is actually used to monitor the transformer assets in Toronto. Funny story about Toronto is that their power grid is underground, and which is in for 95% of the problems of a power grid is a really, really good thing. But they also get a lot of snow in Toronto and then put a bunch of salt on top of that snow to melt it. And that salt melts the snow and goes down into the sewers, which also contain a lot of the electrical lines and start corroding the electrical equipment. And they started having this phenomenon where old grandmothers would be waiting for the bus and put their hand on a pole next to the bus and electrocute themselves because the moisture forged a, you know, made a connection to the actual transformer and its insulative properties had degraded below. So in the interest of saving grandmothers in Toronto, we developed a solution to help them manage their transformer usage data. So this is classic time series data. In fact, they're just really fancy smart meters attached to these transformers, and what it allows you to do is go from estimating by putting various expensive dedicated sensors around the grid, you know, put five of them here, watch them for, you know, 9 months and see what happens. This gives you visibility into the actual operations of those assets. We can take that information and then build a data-driven model to understand their usage and their degradation and their likelihood of failure so that we can optimize the allocation of replacements across that fleet and ultimately optimize the capital expense and save grandmothers everywhere. So those kinds of use cases, and the reason I put these screenshots up is they highlight a couple of patterns. One is time series data tends to also be associated with locations. Sensors are usually on things, and that some of those things move, in which case you've got to watch the thing the sensor is attached to moving around. In other cases, they're on stationary objects scattered around a city, and you can then become aware of the state of a fleet of assets in geographic location. And so that's one big use pattern where you want to understand that real-time state, right, that horizontal query, but also you have the requirements of that vertical query, right? The models that tell us which of these transformers are likely to fail are based on those vertical query patterns and hooking up predictive modeling tools to them. So these are the kind of applications we're thinking of. How do we take historical time series data, build predictive models that do pattern recognition or forecast the next interval, and then how do we operationalize those, right? Because it's actually much easier to do the model construction by sucking data out. It takes a while, it's a pain, but it works. Operationalizing models is also a very difficult problem. So to reduce it a bit, how do we hook these things up to that thing, right? These things being some common analytical tools, it's certainly not exhaustive, but a lot of our clients use SAS. I actually came from SPSS to Accenture, so I know and love Clementine very well, and R is a popular open source data mining tool that's very, very powerful as well. And we'd like to use these things on the data that's in Cassandra, problem being all of these things were designed for relational databases. So we've been kicking the tires with various integration patterns to understand how we hook those guys up. So one choice, and there's typically not one answer to these problems, but an analytical workflow goes typically through some sort of offline study mode where you're exploring the data, exploring relationships, and understanding what the potential inputs and outputs, or what the potential inputs to a model are, how they interact, and things like that. And in a lot of those cases, sampling out some data, getting in an R, which is, you know, friendly and familiar to many statisticians, and being able to run various statistical procedures to understand that data is perfectly acceptable. And we see a lot of people doing that, and we do that ourselves. So we use the ODBC and JDBC connecting capabilities of various of these various tools and ways to get at the data in Cassandra. It's not limited, by the way, to those tools. You can do this with Tableau. You can do this with all kinds of different tools, and there's a lot of tools in the world, obviously, that support ODBC and JDBC kind of connections. It is sucking the data out, right? So you probably want to sample, unless you've got another equally sized large distributed data store you're going to put it into, but then you're going to have the same problem of, well, how do I do analytics on it? So you're probably sampling, but at some point you're going to want to take the insight or the model you're able to build, maybe it's a regression, and you want to actually run that over the full data set, either to predict, maybe to run the overnight batch that does recommendations or that kind of thing. And when you run over the full data set, you probably don't want to pick up the data set, suck it through all those arrows that go to that point up there, and then send it to, if you're lucky, a distributed cluster of analytics tools. So we exist in this world where, on the one hand, we've got a distributed data store. On the other hand, we have distributed statistical and analytical tools, but no way of moving the data between them efficiently. So what we end up doing is distributing a query, getting a result set out, and then redistributing that result set so the analytics tool can run that parallel algorithms on its different kind of parallel architecture over those. So every time I get a chance to talk to anybody from a statistical or modeling tool vendor, I ask them to solve that problem and sit directly on top of these architectures, and they tell me they're working on it. And there is some very, very interesting work over at Greenplum. They're looking at how to run their analytical engine directly on Hadoop nodes as well as Postgres nodes, so abstracting the storage node technology with the processing architecture on top of it. We'll see some things there over the next 5-10 years, but we're pretty much in this boat for a while. We can run MapReduce against these nodes, right? So I've shown sort of the classic analytical Cassandra cluster, with some of the nodes serving the analytical purposes, and that's one way of doing analytics. And you can do some pretty complex thing, but you're doing a lot of custom coding and stuff like that. Statisticians aren't the world's greatest data flow developers, and they're not necessarily the world's greatest coders, nor do I want them. If they work for me, I don't want to actually have them spending tons of time learning to be those things. There's other people in the world that are good at those things, and if we can create an architecture that makes it more tractable to them, it's goodness. For now, we tend to team them up so that when we figure out what we want to do using the tool sets that support efficient high iteration workflows, and then encode the fruits of that process in a much more custom and heavy or heavyweight way to make it run in parallel over the actual clusters. So on the one hand, we'll use things like MapReduce against the cluster to do that. On the other hand, we'll use Mahout and things like that on top of MapReduce to do some things that it does nicely. But we all look forward to the day when we can switch nicely between these modes without necessarily having this great divide of, do I have to sample over to my tool universe and then implement back? It slows things down, but it's the best we can do. So when we hook up R, we've got a few ways that I'll highlight from that last one, right? But there's a JDBC connector. You can also use Hive in conjunction with it, and then there's the R Cassandra package, which really isn't a means of connecting. It's a way of writing MapReduce and what feels like R to a statistician. But like I said, in most cases, when we're using a tool like R, we're sampling them into a data frame on R or a SAS file on SAS, or SPSS has some nice characteristics of actually treating data nicely in a database. But it's just creating a temporary file in the background anyway. So we're still in a world that does that, but it does allow us to take that time series utility data and do things like, hey, let's look and see, oh, power usage is increasing over time. some of this is based on my actual data. So you can see that peak over on the right is when I got my recording studio up and running after it had been dormant for a little while. And you can do things to start look at intervals and understand monthly intervals and predict intervals and things like that. You could also do things like clustering and use Mahout's built-in clustering algorithms to understand clusters of usage patterns and things like that. So there is a range and a palette of things we can do with the data. Our methods change when we're in exploratory versus explanatory mode and things like that. But we have some very, very powerful capabilities and can do some very, very interesting things. Which I say because we, as you recall, I started out, it's a time series analytical repository. It's easy to create a data store. We were joking in the earlier session. It's easy to store a bunch of data, but what do you do with it? And so it's by getting these tools hooked up to it and these processes and workflows enabled that we can actually get the value out of that data. I did start earlier by talking a bit about the importance of visualization to unlock a lot of the insight of these things. So I will endeavor to do one of those never try this at home live demo. So this is a little visualization we built up around our utility data. And on the one hand, you know, there's a lot of schools of thought on time series data, but we've thrown a couple up here to show some novel ways of looking at it. And one of them is to essentially, you know, the days of the week are on the left and the time of the day is on the right. And this helps us understand if I'm a creature of habit by hour or by day. Now, I'm a wage slave working for one of America's great large companies, so I'm a, you know, Monday through Friday kind of person in terms of being out of my house. But as you move through different, whoops, I gotta scroll down so you can see that. As we move through different weeks here, you can see my patterns change pretty extensively. And then we can go over here and start to see where I took a week off or took a long day in the studio. So I drove a lot of consumption there, and then, you know, these weekdays seem to be pretty mellow, and that pattern tends to hold across weeks with some notable exceptions. Maybe somebody was working from home over here on these days. In fact, I think it probably was. So it's a way of understanding patterns across different dimensions and reducing what could, you know, really be driven. I could, instead of looking at discrete weeks, be driving averages off of 10 years of consumption here and getting insight into to whether or not or how strong some patterns are in ways that are very difficult to quickly discern with other techniques. The other benefit that these technologies allow us, especially with a lot of the real-time querying capabilities, we can really start to interact with data in fun ways, right? And so I can start doing things like, you know, to what I was looking at before, and I can just say, okay, let's just look at Monday through Friday and see what my consumption does. And, you know, on the one hand, we've got some visualization libraries that implement filters across different views of data, and that's a fun trick at the JavaScript level. On the other hand, we've got to have an efficient architecture delivering this data behind it when you fire up the query, right? So, so connecting a dashboard, if you will, although I hate calling this a dashboard, it's far more interactive than most dashboards, and up to that data store to allow that interactive process of querying and understanding puts you in a position to put normal people who think about business problems in a role of capability where they can start to interact with data that's in a highly complex distributed data store, and they don't know that there's a Cassandra summit going on here where there's a bunch of awesome people collected who really, really like distributed data stores and geek out on databases, which I love to do too. But if this technology is truly to take off, we need to empower the business user to get access to what's hiding therein, right? And so these kinds of visualization solutions really enable that in a way that is intuitively valuable to a lot of decision makers. And so it's interesting in that a friend, J.C. Hertz, gives a talk at Strata that some folks may have seen where she talks about the power of shiny visualization to sell executives, and that's certainly true. Put one of these up in front of an executive, and they will get very, very excited about the ability to browse the data around their department or what have you. But there is a substantive value to it as well. There are things that you can see through visualization that in any other way are very, very difficult to discern. There's a famous quadrant of four graphs of, that have essentially regression fit lines that all have the same line and the same R value, and you can have all kinds of different distributions of data that get you that summary view. And only by looking at the data plotted on a two-coordinate plane can you really see the differences in that distribution. Even by looking at the individual data points in a table, it's still very, very difficult to discern the differences in those patterns. So visualization, on the one hand, is an excellent sales tool to get executives to buy things, and I don't shy away from using it, and I don't think anybody should, but it is also a very substantive technology and technique to bringing the information contained in a massive data store to a decision maker in a compelling way. And as these data stores get bigger and as this data gets more and more used in an organization, the ability to shorten the cycle time between looking at it like this and storing it in the cluster in the first place will get reduced over the next several years as lots of people are working on sort of making this world and the cluster work better together. But but for today, we've got a lot of different kinds of, I don't want to call them hacks, but architectures with certain flaws that we put up with that as we smash that architecture, right, as we go back and look at the... let me get this guy out of the way. As we go back and look at the... I just put it in full screen. As we go back, we'll see, there we go, that we can smash that inflection point up there, and we can start running data directly on the nodes, and as what's running in those nodes becomes more versatile, right, to the point about things like green plum on Hadoop, as we realize the abstractions of the analytic layer and the storage layer in such a way that we can have analytical engines that play nicely with distributed storage architectures, we're going to have analytical capabilities that are profoundly better than we do today. We'll be able to shorten that cycle where even still efficiently working with a large data set like this, you're talking about, you know, periods of hours, not minutes or seconds to actually get a good sample out into an analytical tool and work with it enough to know that you have a good sample and things like that. And while it's better than the several days that it might have taken us 5 years ago on different architectures, we would still, as an analytics person, love to just magically snap out a billion rows and run it through a model like that, and we will get there over time. But hopefully I've been able to give you, you know, a decent view into how we're hooking analytics tools up to this, and in particular around time series data. You know, we have a set of analyses that these tools are very sufficient for, and we can support a lot of the use cases that we need to. Over time, we'll be able to sort of support them better, and hopefully the tools will continue to progress and enable us to do very, very more game-changing things and more game-changing kinds of analytics on top of these. So with that, I will open the room up to questions. There's a microphone coming your way.
Very interesting talk. Couple of questions. First, when you were talking at the beginning about specialized hardware for a relational database, oh, you were specifically talking about like massively parallel processing of queries, like the Clustrix or the Pascal or whatever?
The particular hardware appliance that we used was not a massively parallel RDBMS infrastructure. It was a traditional RDBMS infrastructure.
And have you done any comparison with the MPPs now?
We're actually doing that right now, so I don't have the results of it, but we are looking at it.
Okay. Second query is, in this diagram, you showed this inflection point, but it actually, a lot of people are just pre-computing or number crunching on Hadoop and then reducing the amount of data that really needs to be stored for the visualization to a much smaller, you know, more either relational or Cassandra, whatever, like data store where they actually pull the visualization out of from. And what that has, the problem there is you have to do things in batch. But with like something like Twitter Storm, you could actually do some of those computations on the fly. What is your opinion on that?
So one thing I didn't really capture here was the role of a CEP engine on the way in, which Twitter Storm is sort of a, I'd love to see it grow up into a really full-fledged CEP engine. Right now, it's a really good way of counting and incrementing and doing some fun things on the way in. So most, if you're dealing with fat pipes of sensor data, it's always going to be desirable, if you can, to do sort of value-added transformations on the way in, because it's there, it's in memory, or it's in some addressable space, and you can do something with it. So, so in our operational smart grid architectures, often the monitoring solution is running off of a CEP engine that's sitting at the head of that pipe. And TwitterStorm is sort of an example of that across different sort of web use cases, right? But essentially, it's sitting there doing things as stuff comes in. That's one important way to do that. Now, if your data isn't necessarily truly time series, we do a lot of architectures that, for instance, one over at NetApp, which has been presented at different conferences, where we're actually aggregating things. We're storing, the first place of residence is Hadoop. We do some transformations out of Hadoop, in that case into some enterprise data warehouses. In other cases, we do it into Cassandra. So we have actually put Hadoop, HDFS Hadoop, next to Cassandra to support those kinds of workflows, because there is enough unique properties and benefits to the two different things that that makes sense. If it's truly time series data, Cassandra has those properties that make it pretty compelling to do it in there, but a lot of the world's data isn't time series data, and a lot of that contextual data might be, so they can be very complementary.
So you talked earlier about bringing the context to the data, and so I'm thinking sort of in the example that you're showing, where you're talking about a smart energy grid and you're showing someone their usage, piece of context that might seem really important is the out exterior temperature of the sort of atmosphere during that day to show you how that changes over time. Would you remodel the data to bring that piece of context in the same place, or would you just model that as a separate time series data and then transform them together in a background process? And
so,
how would that work?
So very good question. In that particular instance, because you've got kind of a one-to-many relationship in terms of there's going to be one contextual temperature reading to many time series around individual consumption, there's a strong motivation not to combine those and to combine those at the presentation layer, because essentially in that sort of that portal use case, at least none of the utilities I've ever had ever do anything terribly interesting. They just, yes, it was hot and I was running air conditioning. Your air conditioner seems to run 10% more than your neighbor's cycling on and off during a heat wave. Maybe you should like insulate your windows or dry your shades down or something, right? When that analytic becomes necessary, if you're starting to do something interesting, then it maybe does make sense to start appending to your model. And one of the nice things is, just add a column family, right? So we don't necessarily have to go rip and replace our whole architecture. We can just build that in ways that allow us to access it. Because as Matt said in the last section, today we have to bring all the data to one place. The really, pipe smoke and vision of analytics in the future will allow algorithms to traverse data stores without having to get everything in one place, but we're stuck with that for quite some time, I suspect. And so, yeah, when you have a compelling analytical use case, you will probably end up bringing that data into one place.
I was just curious how long you ran your cluster and how many columns do you end up with, because typically one problem you would run into with the model that you just described is you will end up, the query performance will degrade over time because you'll end up creating a lot of tombstones, the columns that get deleted.
So good question. It would be 96 times 365 would be the number of columns. In that particular exercise, so a year, 96 reads a day, 365 days in a year, and then a million rows, or essentially meters. But they were talking about how you can use time to live as an effective archiving tool, right? And so that you use time to live, and if your workloads allow you, or you're really only interested in the last 3 months, you can use time to live to sunset the old columns, and then there's techniques that you are not actually throwing that out, you're archiving it, right? So you can get you essentially use the time to live of columns to manage how long you're keeping things and managing that performance. There's you would be looking at sort of, on the one hand, how can you scale out to increase your ability to do that? And then essentially, like I said, you still have the challenge of managing the width of that table. Time to live gives you a very nice way of doing that. All right, well, thank you, everybody. It's been a real pleasure, and enjoy the rest of the conference.